and welcome to UDC Forum. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber, Director for the Humanities at the University of the District of Columbia Community College, and your host. Fashion merchandising is the study of fashion trends to determine merchandising strategy for a retail store or fashion product provider. It's an exciting field that demands both an intuition for fashion trends and a shrewd understanding of business management. The Fashion Merchandising Program at the University of the District of Columbia Community College is designed to fulfill the needs of those students who are seeking a career in the corporate side of the fashion industry. Joining me today to talk about more of the business side of the fashion industry is Oliver Davis, a Washington, D.C. fashion designer, owner of the Matador Shop, and the creator and designer of all the fashions you see me wearing, hosting the UDC Forum. Oliver has also provided internships for students in the Fashion Merchandising Program at the University of the District of Columbia Community College. Welcome.
Thank you.
Now, I talked about that you designed the fashions for me, and I'm just so excited that we met. And the idea of becoming a designer is one that a lot of our students have and a lot of people have. We know historically fashion has been a way for people to express themselves, especially when we look at the history of African American women. There was a time when they weren't allowed to wear bold colors and makeup and things of that nature. But of course, times have changed. Talk a little bit about what you see fashion being and the meaning of it.
Self-expression. Self-expression for the individual who wears the fashion and self-expression for the artist who creates the fashion.
Now, one of the things that we noted was that you provided internships for our students at the University of the District of Columbia Community College in that merchandising program. What is important about doing that, and why did you open your shop to that?
I found that to date, that's probably one of the most beneficial and rewarding experiences in my career, was being able to assist students who are interested in the fashion industry. They not only helped me with different things, for instance, social media. Now, I'm sort of an older person, so I'm not real versed on the modern day technology and staying in the game. I can create, but it's just hard staying modern. So the students from the university to come in, it helped me. They'd write up little emails or proposals for me. They would help me with my social media or photographing or even accessorizing. You know, as a designer myself, sometimes you're more focused on the outfit opposed to the complete look, and being able to take that outfit and reach all different age groups from between the ages of 21 to 70, you know, so it's just, they were able to keep me fresh and modern.
Now, I see that you're sewing here. And why? Are you on deadline or?
Well, I'm always on deadline. That's the one thing about my craft, it's that it's deadline. But this is something that I'm in the process of creating my own textiles. You know, after working with all the different prints and being such inspired by the different cloths that I do work with, in the different areas in which they come from around the world, whether it be from Indonesia or whether it be from the cloth that we get from our motherland, you know, which is authentically hand-dyed and just the texture is a bit different. And I really want to represent more of the motherland with the creations of the clothing through the African textiles. So my introduction to that is now creating my own textiles. So right now I'm working with different pieces that I do dye myself. I'm working with pieces that are remnants left over from some of the different creative pieces that I've created. And I'm building my own story, which in return will be placed on the person who wants to wear this story. And also with this, I'm also able to take in pieces from different clients and friends who have very important pieces that may not be constructed, may have fallen apart or may have gotten stained or made that they can't use anymore, and we take those pieces apart and we incorporate those pieces into their current lifestyle. So that's also very important. And like I said, the most rewarding was working with the students here. They would come to the shop and I had a few that were really interested in just working with me, and that was a really important, really great feeling. So they come in, you know, we said, and they give me their ideas. And at the shop, I would even sell some of their merchandise. Some of them would make hats, some of them would make dresses, you know, and that was really rewarding again.
And some made bags because I purchased a beautiful bag that one of the students made.
Yeah.
You talked about telling your story through the clothing. And of course, historians and everyone's really interested, but that's certainly intriguing about telling a story. And when you talked about incorporating people's fabrics and things that are maybe mementos and family pieces that were passed down. So that's sort of a artistic collage that we're talking about, that people are actually wearing some of that history.
Right.
How did you get to that point? What was your journey to get to the point where you're creating historical pieces?
And that's what they are. That's what that was. That's the main thing, is the historical. I far down the road after I'm gone, I want these pieces to remain. And as I look and as I take in different garments from people, even altering or fixing this, I get a lot of things that I look at the production, I look at the quality level, and I look at the style, and I want my things to last, you know, us lift their heirlooms and to be passed down. So I've taken the time to really learn to the fabric and feel, getting in touch with the fabric and feeling the fabric and moving into creating my own textiles with strips of cloth and creating them. I'm feeling and I'm getting the flow, you know. It's also bringing me to, I'm seeing design, I'm seeing movement, and also, like I said, the story. Like, here you have the continent, the country, and we're mixing this with the textiles from, like I said, Indonesia, and the textiles that I found on a dress that I had did for a lady that we had to return and refix him, shorten, so I was able to incorporate that. So, and the other part about it is I love connecting, and each piece that I connect, that I create, especially with the handmade textiles now, are connecting people. And to me, that's the most important thing, is the connection. Where you may be walking down the street tomorrow and you may see a strip on a lady that's the same, or on a gentleman, that's the same as the piece that you have on today. And there's and you both recognize each other and you know that, oh, well, hey, that's, where'd you get that? And it's, oh, the Matador. So it's a connection. Each piece is connecting individuals, whether it be local or whether it be abroad. There's a connection, and that's the most important thing to me, and the motivation behind what I do is connecting my people.
And the connection, I recently was in Senegal in Dakar, and I had your fabrics and your designs on, and the colleague I was visiting, Dr. Jones, introduced me to a circle of friends and some tailors, and they were very much impressed with your work, to the point where they asked me if you were an African tailor, and I said no, you were an African American designer and tailor, and they were very much impressed with the work. And they didn't think that overall there was that quality. They are very skilled at this, in Dakar especially, and in Senegal. So they were surprised to see that level. And when I explained that to you, you were very excited to hear that kind of comment.
Yes.
But what started you in fashion? What was the beginning of that journey?
Boy, my beginning in fashion. I'd say I was probably around 8. And growing up, rural towns, you know, clothing was not always available, and unlimited income, of course, as most of us, we come up through the way. And so it was about, I was sort of proportioned a little bit differently than the kids in my peer group in the 70s. I mean, you know, most people were a little smaller in the thighs, and they didn't have the span in the waist or in the back. So I always had to wear jeans that were not special made, but husky. So to fit the thighs, it had to fit, that meant the leg was a little bit bell-bottom or full, just to keep the flow. So, and at that time, there really weren't many, couldn't find things that were couture, you know, fit the thigh and slim down at the leg. So I would take a needle and thread, as I'm doing today, and I would actually go into the inseam of my pant, and I would narrow that leg out, you know, balance it out. It wasn't, now that I think back on it, it wasn't the best job I've ever done, but... it was my way of fitting into mainstream, into school, and not being laughed at because you had on bell bottoms. So it sort of was a need. you know, and I would grew up in a time where there was Calvin Klein and there was Jordache, and once again, I couldn't fit those pants. So, but a lot of the students in my school wore them, and I wanted to fit in. So we would go to different, my mom had a craft for thrift stores. So we did a lot of that. And we would find, I would find those ripped jeans, the Calvin Klein jeans, and I would find the Jordache jeans, and I would, to fit in, I would take those tags off the back of those pants that we would buy for a dollar and a quarter maybe back then, and I would hand sew them to the back of my Huskies, because Huskies had no insignia, no label. They were just plain pockets, and I laugh about those times, you know, today, just, you know, fitting in. And it be, like I said, my craft started out as a need to be accepted, and it blossomed into a career that you still balance the world of being accepted, and that's where I'm at.
Was anyone sewing in your family? Your mother, your grandmother?
You know, my sister was a seamstress for herself. She was, once again, like I said, in the 70s. My sister's maybe 62 now, so we grew up, you know, graduating high school in the 70s. She was a, back then, I would say today's modern 14. Not a big girl, but she had hips and she had curves, and she couldn't fit things in the store. So she started making her own. So she crafted some beautiful garments, and her biggest fetish was shoes, because if she couldn't spend the money on the clothes, she would make the clothes and then spend the money on the shoes. So back then she was dropping $80-$90 on a pair of shoes in the 70s and 80s, you know, but the shoe was a great shoe, which she still has in her closet to this day. But it was, that was, I guess, one of the biggest inspirations, and that's where I was able to get the needle and thread to learn. I didn't, to hand sew. And so I did that. And in the early mid 80s, I took a sewing class in high school when most of the gentlemen were taking a shop. I was a sort of a trailblazer in the, like I said, in the rural community, and took home ec sewing and learned how to actually thread my first machine. At that point, my sister was married, and, you know, times have changed. And from there, I started learning to sew, not by just hand, but by machine. And I took a break from that for, oh, maybe 8 years, and then landed a job with a Joann Fabrics and started taking some sewing classes with them, and had some interns with different theaters and learned my craft. I worked with the different couturiers in New Orleans with a Mardi Gras gowns, where I learned actually how to hand sew, you know, correctly, in the different, so many different stitches that it takes to bring forth a garment. And one of my, and during that time, I learned that the finishing and how important the finishing garments are, and the inside should always look as good as the outside. That has never, that's always stuck with me, is that, because people, we look inside of our things more than we look on the outside, because we're putting them on. So, and that's close to our bodies, and they should feel just as wonderful on the inside as they look on the outside.
You were saying about the Mardi Gras, the gowns and things of that nature. Where is your, is there a favorite kind of design that you like? Is it something that's more of the ball gowns and the festive garb, or just creating something that's unique?
It varies. It varies. It comes and it goes, and it depends on the inspiration at this point in my life. Back then, it was based on the need to survive, so you took the jobs and the learning and the experience, because that was my training as well, and I'm thankful for each and every opportunity that I had, whether it be making pants for a play, or even, like I said, embellishing Mardi Gras gowns, both hand stitching appliques, or stitching wheels on the back of mantles so that when they drug, when you walk, those mantles would flow and they would drag. And it was just learning the insides of how to make things beautiful from the inside out, and how to make things function, because fashion is function. And that's something that we don't, as a designer, you have to think about. Is it functional? Can you walk? Can you wear it? Not just stand and be beautiful, but can you function in it? So it was learning that foundation is what has me able to complete different types of designs. I can make a ball gown fit for Queen of Africa or Queen Elizabeth, or I can make a suit fit for a modern day woman, or a pair of pants fit for a modern day man going to work. I really appreciated that, like the last 16 years of construction, and that's where I am.
One of the things I like about the relationship you have with your clients is that you actually listen and talk to them to understand what it is they want and how it's going to fit into their lifestyle.
Yes.
And like the function of it as well. So talk about that relationship and what drove you to have one that's so, I want to say intimate in the sense that you know their fashion, mm-hmm. their fashion wants.
Mm-hmm. The inspiration for that is the individual. I struggle a lot with, and on a daily basis, struggle a lot with self-identity, self-identifying and self-esteem, self-confidence. And so when I see a muse like yourself, I'm instantly, I gravitate toward that person and they gravitate toward me and we build a story together. And having that history of being a kid that wasn't slim-thighed, you know, and couldn't fit into things, I realized how important it is to our community to have someone able to offer that fit. Because, like I said, coming from a time when clothes weren't necessarily designed for our bodies, and different fashion designers even would state that they didn't make our clothes to fit African-American bodies or fuller bodies, let's just say. And that, and being a person that grew up with that problem, it was really important for me to be able to accommodate sizes in women and men with body features that aren't the norm. Even today, when you still look, you hear different celebrities and different people talking about the fit. And it's just very important to have something that you feel comfortable in, that you can function in, that isn't necessarily a stretch garment, you know, and function.
One of the one of your signatures, I think, is the way that you use the fabric. That's the dramatic fabric. That's sort of an African fabric and is African fabrics. Talk about the statement pieces.
The statement pieces. Before I got involved with the cloth, I worked with a lot of different textiles, you know, from satins to silks to linens to cottons to polyesters to a lot of different cloths, but and I could construct those and do them well, and learn the different needles and the things that you need, the threads and the things that you needed to bring those and give them longevity and functionality, seams so that they can move. You know, I was introduced to the cloth by you, and that's been about 4 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And it's been a journey that has taken my business over the moon. And I thank you for that and the inspiration that you give to the business and to the aesthetic and to the design. And the cloth just, it opened up a whole new world for me. And it's bold, it's representative, it's a statement within itself. And each piece that I get, sometimes I just look at them and it's just like, wow, what can you do with this? And you can bring this to life. It's almost like walking art. And that, like I said, has been the foundation now of the Matador Shop, is being noted for the respect and the homage and the well tailorship and the construction and the love of the cloth for the person who not only sees this cloth as a novelty, as a way of life. And it's fashion trends, they come and they go. And over the last 4 years, I've noticed the great trend in the African cloth and textiles being represented in society today. For a while, I did believe that, well, is this gonna be a trend, or is this gonna go, or is this gonna come? But like I said, as that has happened, I've adopted a new motto that this is not just a novelty, this is not just a trend, that this is now a way of life for me, and I welcome anyone who uses the cloth as a way of life to create a work of art for them that they can pass down and become an heirloom in their life, and hopefully one day ends up in the African American museum.
Yeah, it's interesting you said the novelty. You're right, it's no longer a novelty. There are some people that will say, well, I need an outfit for an occasion.
Right.
But for me and for many women, it's not an outfit. This is your wardrobe. This is what you wear. This is how you represent how you feel about yourself and your history.
Right.
So there's a lot of, you know, fashion does do more than just clothe you.
Right.
And it's allowing people to be very expressive. Mm-hmm. So what you've done is taken the cloth, as you call it, and used it for a functional piece. Mm-hmm. And it's not just an outfit. It's not just we're having something at church and I need an African outfit, or I'm going to an event, I need an African outfit. Mm-hmm. It's now people, men and women, are thinking, I want a suit. This is the fabric I want the suit in. Or I want a dress. This is the fabric I want the dress in. And it's not for a special occasion so much, and it may be, but this is, I need a dress, and this is the dress that I want, or this is the fabric that I want it in. So we see a change in attitude as well.
Right.
And I have many friends who, this is their wardrobe.
Right.
And many who, I'm Howard 60s and 70s grad.
Yes.
So many who were dressing in an African cloth long before it became an established norm.
Right.
And now it's fabric. There are so many high-end designers who are African designers that are designing using the cloth.
Right.
And so to be able to translate the cloth not only into an everyday wardrobe but into a historical piece is really quite interesting.
Right.
You had made a comment about the fashion scene here in the District of Columbia. What is it like being a fashion designer in Washington, D.C.?
Being a fashion designer in Washington, D.C. has been a really nice, it's been a great opportunity. I find that there is a sense of awareness here that, and I believe that's what drew me to this town, even before I got involved with the love of the cloth. It's, and there's a, with the universities, there's just a sense of belonging, and there's a sense of identifying with who we are and being proud of that, and being able to display it, and to be able to be a part of that, and to be able to incorporate the cloth into clothing that you can wear to work is very important. Because most, when people used to think, they would think about the cloth being in the longer dresses or even just ceremonial and so forth, but being a part of the movement where you can now take this cloth and incorporate it into everyday life has been a journey that I'm in, a ride that I'm enjoying. And each day you see a new silhouette that's a simple silhouette, but now if you introduce it to the cloth, it becomes now bold and beautiful creation. And these are the things, like I said, the testament of the cloth. And my goal is like to one day just to have these things hanging in the museum. And that's why I like to take the time to create them and to make them beautiful and to supply the right underlinings and supply the right fabrics that help mend the fabric and help hold the fabric together and help preserve the fabric, opposed to just stitching it to where it, if you put it in the washer, it may go away, you know, or it may disintegrate, or it may fall apart, you know. And another thing is working with my own textiles is I want them to be stable. And the one thing I've learned that coming from a lot of the fabrics that I get from abroad or Indonesia, a lot of them are thin, you know, and a lot of, with the dyeing process weakens the fabric, you know. So it takes a lot of underwork to keep that and make it last. And that's what I think I've become known for, is preserving the cloth. Like I said, not just a novelty, but a way of life, and giving it longevity, and where it can stand 100 years from now, you know, encased in a glass, and it will still be this same design that Matador or Oliver Davis created. And that's the legacy that I want to leave behind with the cloth. I was asked to showcase a collection in New York Fashion Week in 2017. And they found my work online, and they were very impressed with the design aesthetic of the cloth and how we modernized it and how we brought it to current and how fashions continue to change and continue to grow, so will my design aesthetic with the fabrics and the cloths.
Now, viewers, how will they be able to get in touch with you to contact you about this?
Okay. I'm on social media. I have an Instagram, it's the Matador Shop. My Facebook is the Matador Shop. And you can also, my email is thematador.od@gmail.com. And we'll get in touch with me and I'll get back in touch with you.
Okay, the New York Fashion Week, I was there. It was absolutely wonderful. And I think you made quite an impression. So it is just great having you here. And I hope that individuals understand from what you're saying that they can utilize the cloth, and it doesn't have to be just for a fancy occasion. It can be the way you live and the way you wear your clothes. Thank you very much for joining me today.
Thank you.
If you're interested in learning more about the academic programs and events offered by the University of the District of Columbia, visit the university's website at www.udc.edu. And to learn more about the many degree, certificate, and training programs offered by the University of the District of Columbia Community College, please visit the website at www.cc.udc.edu. Thank you for watching. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber.